May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer.
Amen. Amen.
Lately, I've been thinking a bit about birds and trees. I've always delighted in awakening to the morning, good morning chirps from various birds as they sing their songs. My first childhood pet was a parakeet. I named him Dandy K after a horse that was running in the Kentucky Derby that year. Now, Dandy K was one of those green parakeets adorned with the variations of green shades. And I was fascinated at this young age that a bird that I'd previously observed outside, not that particular one, but birds outside flying, now there was a bird encapsulated in a cage in my home for me to look at. Inside the cage was the usual, a tray for food, container for water, and some sort of a bird toy. At the bottom, the cage was lined with paper. Remember watching my mother clean the bird cage, which included removing the soiled paper at the bottom. And the sight of that grossed me out. It was nasty. The next pet that came into our home came in a bowl filled with water, goldfish. I was a little older then and enjoyed sprinkling just enough, not too much food, to overfeed the goldfish and lead to its demise. Feeding the goldfish and watching it swim around. But it did not take long for me to observe that the water became polluted and then needed to be changed. It was disgusting, something I did not want to be bothered with. The next pets in our house were dogs. One dog was named Sparky, who was a mixed breed and wild, always got out of the yard, jumped the fence and climbed the fence and liked to chase cars and got hit by a car once, and my grandfather made a splint for the little dog to promote healing. Then after Sparky, we had a beautiful collie that looked just like Lassie. We named her Sheena. I loved looking out the window at Sheena and thinking about Lassie and singing that song and all of that. Now, of course, dogs come with a different type of pickup regarding cleanliness. One that I remained a spectator to. I just couldn't imagine it. Now, let my mother know that pets would be great if no cleanup were involved. Her response, well, anything that takes in food, sustenance, will have an output. Then there's cleanup. There's no way around it. For me, an amusing situation, a solution to the situation would have been the pet rock. Some of you remember the pet rock. Nothing required. It just sat there. What I pivoted to, however, was houseplants. That is my preference. They are fed, they grow, some flower. I have 34 potted houseplants, 11 of them African violets, which I love to propagate and give away. Whether plants or pets, it's hard to escape the evidence of God's creation. All we have to do is look in the mirror. Look at Atlanta's tree canopy that lures a variety and an abundance of birds that enjoy being here. Some of you will recall earlier this year, the Eastern Phoebe that perched on my iPhone and kind of flew at me as I preached on the labyrinth out there. Then for the past 3 weeks, almost a month now, you heard it, but you probably didn't notice what it was. There's a crow that knocks up here on these windows. You may have heard that sound, didn't think anything about it, but that crow has been coming and calling, knocking on the windows. I wish I could find a way to make it a member as it's trying to get in. There's one thing that connects us all as human beings throughout the world. It's realizing that we are not responsible for oceans and seas and species of animals and insects, flowers, trees, vegetables, fruits, and more, and each other. We're not responsible for any of that creation. God is. We are rapidly approaching the summer solstice. It's coming next Sunday. On that day, we will enjoy peak sunlight of 15 hours and 22 minutes, 1 minute more than what we'll have today. And then a slow diminishment of light until we reach the winter solstice, December 21st, 10 hours and 19 minutes of light. What are we to make of or do with these extra hours of light, given electricity provides light inside and outside for many in this country? We don't even think about it. The sun sets on its own, but we turn out our own lights at night. The Bible ties us to one another, the common bond of nature, and sometimes antiquity meets contemporary culture. The author of Mark's Gospel spoke and wrote to a seedling of a community threatened by persecution from religious leaders and the Roman Empire as they strive to follow Jesus. They are the ones who immediately inherited Jesus' message of love, hope, resurrection, reconciliation, renewal, and healing. And seemingly faced, because they were in a small number compared to those around, an insurmountable challenge: spread the gospel throughout the world. Deep inside early Christianity abided a belief that God so loved the world that a son was given so that everyone who believed would have eternal life. And even though they were facing danger, they pushed forward to spread the good news. The parable of the mustard seed was shared to encourage those who were discouraged. They would have known that that tiny seed planted in the earth would over time spring up. A miraculous transformation, sprout and grow and become home to a multitude of birds. What a beautiful picture to paint or animation to create. Can't you just see it? A two-dimensional or three-dimensional animation of this huge tree and all of these birds gathering and sitting on the branches. But what about the mess that would fall below? Certain places in downtown areas and in rural spots where there is roosting, there are places that are plagued by bird droppings, so much so that when walking down the street and I've spotted it, I've crossed over to the other side. You don't want to risk, you know, having bird droppings fall on you. That happened to me once when I was 7. We took a family vacation to California, and on the beach, playing, minding my own business, not trying to bother anybody, then suddenly, plop, you know, there was this bird dropping, and I was the seagull. So I was just, I think that's when it all started, that seagull. What if birds were symbolic of us, hanging out in trees, resting and napping, staying siloed with those on our branch, and never venturing above, below, or beyond a particular comfort zone, wasting away? whether the days are long or short? Do we dare to learn more about Jesus? Do we dare to venture out and seek conversations with, build relationships with those like us created in the image of God, but just happen to be not our image? The Apostle Paul wrote, if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. But we don't get to new without some effort on our part. There's no light switch that we can flip up and say, now I'm a new creation. The church's annual invitation to a holy Lent is transferable, if you allow it, to the summertime. In the spirit of Jesus, it would turn you upside down because it's not Ash Wednesday. We're not entering into a desert time. But why not try self-examination and repentance? Prayer, fasting, and self-denial, and reading and meditating on God's holy word as a summer discipline. No need to wait until next year. The seed God has planted within each person yearns to be nurtured. We too have inherited God's love of the world, the gift of God the Son, the gift of the Holy Spirit. This time last year, if you think back, we were uncertain about the pandemic, how long it would last, what was happening. Now, as we move forward to a different place, what are we carrying? What have we learned? Is it the same notion of who God was pre-pandemic for you? Or has there been a revelation that through the great ordeal, you have come to realize that in Christ, you are a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. We may not like the new, but it's not the same. From Ezekiel, we heard God brings low the high tree and makes high the low tree. And the psalmist reminds us, those who are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall bear fruit in old age. They shall be green and succulent. Regardless your age, in Christ, you are a new creation. With each new day, the outer body matures at its own pace as ordained by God. It is not so with the inner life of the Spirit. Growth can happen, but not on its own. God seeks a mutual desire and waits for us to pay attention and tend to our soul life more so than the material life. Here's an interesting quote from Carl Sandburg. There's an eagle in me that wants to soar, and there is a hippopotamus in me that wants to wallow in the mud. There is an eagle in you that wants to soar, and there is a hippopotamus in you that wants to wallow in the mud. There is an eagle in us that wants to soar, and there is a hippopotamus in us that wants to wallow in the mud. Eagle or hippopotamus. At the corner of North Druid Hills and Claremont, some of you know, there was a COVID-19 testing facility set up. Two lines of cars, often backed up. I went there to get tested once. It was not a pleasant experience. But it was there every day a lot of cars. But lately, the cars diminished. The tent was taken down, and one little sign is left there as a remnant. But I have noticed that that parking lot has been repaved. It's fresh. It's new. So if a parking lot can become a new creation, so can you, so can I, so can we. Leave the safety of your tree, soar like an eagle. In Christ, you are or can be, if you so desire, a new creation.